Hi, today we will discuss the pi factor, but first we need to know the purpose of this strength reduction factor. The purposes of the strength reduction factor are the following. First, to account for the probability of understrength members due to variation in material strengths and dimensions. As I have said, for the structural steel or for the reinforcing steel, even though we have a very good quality control, but there will always be variation. But the more so for the concrete mix, there will be higher range of variations in its material strengths. And also with the corresponding dimensions, because we normally say if it is 250 by 400 mm section, but in the actual, it might be smaller or larger. Also, the purpose of the strength reduction factor is to account for inaccuracies in the design equations. Our design equation is not really that accurate. We just derive it using empirical values. Also, we need to reflect the available ductility and the required reliability of the member under the load effects being considered. Later on, we will discuss what is ductility and reliability of the member. And lastly, to reflect the importance of the member in the structure. The more important the member in the structure, the higher the value of the strength reduction. Oh no, the smaller the value of the strength reduction factor P. Like for example, for the column and beam, I will just give you directly the values for columns because this is more important than beams. Normally, columns has the value of pi from 0.65 to 0.75. For beams, normally that's 0.9. So it has a lower value of the strength reduction factor. Note that all other things being equal, brittle failures are assigned lower strength reduction factors to safeguard the structure against failure that may be catastrophic or that may be occur with little or no warning. That's the reason why the column is more important than beams, because beam will collapse, then it is normally localized. But if a column will collapse, then most probably there will be global failure of the structure. Conversely, non-catastrophic ductile failure modes where member strength can be reached with ample warning of failure are assigned larger strength reduction factors. Here is a table for the different strength reduction factor values taken from ECI 21.2.1. Depending on the action or structural element, you will get the strength reduction factor. First, for the moment, axial force or combined moment and axial force, normally the strength reduction is from 0.65 to 0.9. I will tell you later on how that happens. For the shear, normally it's 0.75. So take note, shear is more important than the moment. So it has a smaller strength reduction factor. So with the torsion, that's 0.65. And for the bearing on concrete, that's 0.65. Post-tension anchorage zones, 0.85, brackets and corbels, 0.75, struts, ties, nodal zones, and bearing areas in strut and tie models, 0.75, and for plain concrete element, that's 0.6, and for anchors in concrete elements, that's 0.45 to 0.75. So as you can see, the more important the structure is, it has the lower strength reduction factors. First, we talk about the different notations. Epsilon T is what we call the net tensile strain in extreme layer of longitudinal tension reinforcement at nominal strength. Take note, extreme layer of longitudinal tension reinforcement. Epsilon TY is the value of net tensile strain in the extreme layer of longitudinal tension reinforcement used to define a compression controlled section. So that's another term that you need to be familiarized with, the compression control section. C is the distance from extreme compression fiber to the neutral axis. Here, it has a unit of millimeter. D is the distance from extreme compression fiber to centroid of longitudinal tension reinforcement. That is also in unit of millimeter. D sub T is different from D because D sub T is the distance from extreme compression fiber to centroid of extreme longitudinal tension reinforcement. It has a unit of millimeter. Of course, it's not always the case that D is different from D sub T. Sometimes D is equal to D sub T if there will be only one layer of reinforcement. But for two or more layers, DT is larger than D. So here, in general, D is not equal to DT. However, D is equal to DT for single layer of longitudinal tension reinforcement. Normally, you need to understand that you need to locate where is the tension and the compression side of your member. So it's very important that you know the moment diagram, because according to the moment diagram, it will give you an idea if the particular section of the member is, where is the location of the tension and the compression fiber. So the strength reduction factor for the moment, axial force or combined moment and axial force, is here. We can discuss that one, but before that, section 21.2.2 says strength reduction factor for moment, axial force and combined moment and axial force shall be in accordance with table 21.2.2. And for section 21.2.2.1, for the form reinforcement, the epsilon sub ty shall be equal to fy over es. Fy is the tensile strength of the reinforcement, and es is the modulus of elasticity of the steel. For grid 420 megapascal, the form reinforcement, it shall be permitted to take epsilon ty equal to 0.00. To take note, this is only permitted for grid 420 to be equal to 0.00. For grid 420 rebars, as you can see, epsilon ty is equal to fy over es. Fy is 420 over 200,000 for the modulus of elasticity. Take note, normally the modulus of elasticity of steel is 200,000. So here the ratio is simply 0.0021, approximately is equal to 0.002. So section 21.2.2.1 of the ECI allows us to simplify the value of epsilon ty to be 0.002. Take note that for grid 280 rebars, the epsilon ty is different because fy is 280 divided 200,000, that's 0.0014. So depending on the reinforcement that you are using, you need to use the proper values. Take note, ECI is actually using grid 420 for this particular case, so be careful with that. So this is the strain distribution and net tensile strain according to ECI. So if you have a section like this one, a rectangular reinforced concrete section with the reinforcement in orange, as you can see, there is the outer layer. Take note again, we need tensile reinforcement at tension side of section. Why? Because concrete is weak in tension, so you need to add reinforcement. So in this particular drawing, the compression should be at the top and tension side should be at the bottom. So the topmost portion is the extreme compression fiber, and the bottommost portion of the beam is the extreme tension fiber of the section. So here, as you can see, the strain diagram is a straight line. We considered it to be a straight line, and as you can see, the different notations that we have defined earlier, from extreme compression fiber here, the outer portion or the topmost portion of the beam, this is where we compute the distance C towards the neutral axis. The neutral axis is where the strain is equal to zero. Since we have this strain diagram, maximum at the top portion and maximum at the bottom, and if you have to draw a straight line, you will see the zero value of the strain here. So this is how we locate the neutral axis, that is small letter C. And for the D, taken from the extreme compression fiber towards the centroid of the steel, this is the outer layer of the steel, so D sub T. D is actually taken from the extreme compression fiber to the centroid of the steel. So if there will be six reinforcement here, so you just have to take the centroid at middle of these three parts. But for this particular example, this is only five rebars, so the centroid should be lower. So that's that distance is equal to D. That is why D is equal to D sub T if there will only be one layer of reinforcement. This is the effect of strength reduction factor versus the net tensile strain. So it's very important that you will be able to compute the strain epsilon T, this one, the net tensile strain. According to ECI, if your strain is equal to 0.005 or greater, then your strength reduction factor should be 0.9, this one, the topmost portion. As long as your epsilon T is greater than or equal to 0.005, we call it tension-controlled section. And this is where the beam is classified, tension-controlled. Beam is a tension-controlled member. So your strength reduction factor per beam should be 0.9. For epsilon T is equal to epsilon TY or lower, we call it the compression-controlled section. Normally, columns are classified at this portion. So columns can have a small value of pi, which is equal to 0.65. In between compression controlled and tension controlled is what we call the transition section. The transition is just, you can draw a straight line from this portion, 0.65 to 0.9. So depending on the epsilon T, that is between epsilon TY and 0.005, if it is in transition, you can just compute the corresponding strength reduction factor here. You can do that by ratio and proportion because this is a straight line. Of course, this is for a column with other what we call lateral ties aside from spiral. But if you are using spiral ties, then for compression or columns or compression controlled members, your strength reduction factor is 0.75. But it will not change to the tension control. It's still 0.9. And between the transition, you can just directly compute the strength reduction factor using this straight line also. Okay? So I hope it would be easier for you now to understand why we normally specify a different grades of the rebar. So here, I just put the general equation so that you will not be confused with these values. For 420 rebar, epsilon ty is 0.002. For grade 280 rebar, epsilon ty is 0.0014. You have to use this one in this particular diagram. Again, if you will look at ECI, normally they use 0.002 directly here, but here I just use a general term so that it would be easier for us to transfer from one grade to the other. Like for example, if we want to determine the epsilon T at this particular, or the strength reduction factor for a particular epsilon T that is between epsilon TY and 0.005, or it should be in transition. So you can just use ratio and proportion here. So for that particular one, because normally the only unknown is the strength reduction factor pi, epsilon T is usually given. So this horizontal distance of the triangle is epsilon T minus epsilon TY, and the vertical is the strength reduction factor pi, which is unknown, minus the strength reduction factor of the compression control, and that's 0.65. So we can have this ratio. Looking at the larger triangle, we have 0.005 minus epsilon ty, and here for the tension control and the compression control, so you can have this ratio. And by ratio and proportion, you can just manipulate these equations. I don't have to discuss most of this one because this is just algebraic manipulation. I hope you still know how to do algebraic manipulation. So here is the equation for this particular straight line. So if you have pi sub t, that's 0.09, pi sub c for other reinforcement, that's 0.65, and epsilon t, it should be given, epsilon t y depending on the reinforcement, and you can just compute for the strength reduction part. You don't need to memorize this equation. The important thing is that you know how it was derived. But if you can memorize that one, of course, it will really help you a lot. But again, it's not really important that you have to memorize that one. So in general, the general formula for the transition section is this one. So depending on reinforcement, you can also use the spiral and the other reinforcement in this general equation. So for spirals conforming to 25.7.3, where pi sub c is 0.75, then pi sub t is 0.9, pi sub c is 0.75, pi sub t minus pi sub c is 0.15. So you can just directly substitute these values to the general equation so that you will get the equation for the spiral, this one. For other case, you can use these values as illustrated, and then you will get the other equation. But of course, take note we are using the general equation or general formula for the transition section. As a summary, strength reduction factor versus the knit tensile strain is shown here in the table. Depending on your style, in my case, it's easier for me to understand the graph than this table. But you can always use different ways. You can use the graph or you can use this table for the strength reduction factor. And this is what we have derived earlier. Take note, there is a portion in the table. There is at the bottom, for sections classified as transition, it shall be permitted to use pi corresponding to compression control section. So when you are designing, it's not always possible to compute everything. So the code actually allows us to use value of pi corresponding to the compression control section. We have an example here to compute values of pi for a given beam with material strength Fc prime of 20 megapascal, Fy of 420 megapascal, and epsilon is 200,000 megapascal. Compute the values of pi for other case where epsilon t is 0.001, that's lower than, or this is in the compression control section. Epsilon t of 0.005, that is tension control section, and epsilon t of 0.004, that is a transition. So for grid 420 rebars, epsilon ty is fy over es or 0.002, or as the ECI code actually allows us to use 0.002. For A, epsilon t is 0.001, that is less than epsilon ty, so this is in compression control section. For other case, pi is 0.65. For epsilon t of 0.008, that's greater than 0.005, which is in tension control section. Thus, you can directly use pi equal to 0.9. And for epsilon t, which is 0.004, between epsilon ty and 0.005, this is the transition section. So you can use the formula that we have derived earlier, or you can just directly compute using the graph below. Also, you can see the different cases at graph below for your easy reference. So using the formula that we have derived, pi is equal to 0.8167, or approximately equal to 0.82. Or again, the ECI code footnote of table 21.2.2 permits to use pi corresponding to compression control section. So thus, alternatively, pi can also be equal to 0.65. For the dimensions and tolerances, based on accepted practice, ECI Committee 117 has provided recommended tolerances for concrete construction and materials. You can see these tolerances so that it's not really important that we have to get the absolute dimensions, but it's really difficult to apply all these dimensions absolutely. So we have some tolerances for the particular dimension. Aside from that, we have different handbooks to be used in reinforced concrete. You can use these publications, which contains useful tables and charts, of course, to speed up our design for the experienced designer. So you can use Reinforced Concrete Design Manual by ECI, or the CRSI Design Handbook, PCI Handbook, the Pre-Stress Concrete Institute, and the ECI Detailing Manual. This is very important in your design of reinforced. Aside from that, you can also use software. As I have said, today computer software is used for considerable portion of the design computation. So the designer, especially the inexperienced design engineer, should be wary of using commercial softwares for analysis or design, or for both to do computations that the designer engineer does not thoroughly understand and would be unable to formulate in the absence of the computer program. So I really encourage you to learn spreadsheets, MATCAD or ESMAT Studio. MATCAD is commercial, but you can use ESMAT Studio, that is free, or you can use MATLAB, that is also commercial, or Octave Pro, or you can use Python. These are all free softwares. You can use this for your basic computations, but normally we do use spreadsheets for very simple calculations. But ESMAT Studio can be also useful for procedural design. Also, you can use the different softwares here for your structural analysis and design. The GRASS and GALE, PrimCE, STAAD Pro, SAP 2000, Tekla Structures. What else? You can use the other softwares that can be used for structural analysis and design. So that's all for today, and I hope you'll learn a lot in our topic about the design methods and requirements. Next time, we will discuss portion of the analysis and design of reinforced concrete. Thank you for listening.